afternoon. Welcome to all of you to King's College London, and well done for making it here despite all the travel chaos. I don't know if you guys found it difficult, easy, you're on time, so maybe you guys are all right. A lot of us have struggled, but anyway, we're here. There should be a lot more, but no doubt they're stuck on ladies' tubes. So, on behalf of the Institute of Mathematics and its applications, the IMA, welcome to this afternoon of mathematics geared to sixth form students. My name is Lauren Bradshaw, and I'm Vice President Communications with the IMA, and also a mathematics lecturer at the University of Greenwich, and also an admissions tutor at that institute. So it gives me great pleasure to welcome Hugh Hunt. Hugh is a fellow at Trinity College, Cambridge, reader in engineering dynamics and vibration, and a well-known speaker on TV and radio.
Thank you. Thanks very much. So I think I have to push a button. Sorry, how do I get this back?
Yes, sorry.
Okay, let me see. Laptops, that's it. Great. Excellent. Thanks very much. I lecture engineering in Cambridge University, and engineering is perhaps one of the most applied maths. If you kind of think of physics, well, that's maths applied to the real world. But physics isn't all that much the real world if you think about it, because the equations that apply to physics don't easily apply to things like aircraft and bridges. If you want to design one of these things, well, individual components, individual tiny bits might obey the laws of physics, but trying to make things reliable and make things work, well, that's where engineers come in. Usually, things are done on a scale which is unimaginably big or unimaginably small. So, for instance, these wheels on the plane wouldn't fit into this room, and of course the engines wouldn't. Just you can tell that by this Airbus plane, the size of the windows. And you know what the windows are like on the plane, they're about this big. So the everything's big. And this bridge, but you can barely see the vehicles on the bridge. But if you're thinking about how you might design a bridge, well, it's all very well to think, okay, I've got to work out the tension in these cables. And you might think, oh, that's easy, and forces equal and opposite or one thing or another. But what happens if the wind is blowing? What happens if there's a huge gale? Then how do you work out how this bridge responds? Does it vibrate? How's it going to fall over? Well, the other thing is that these things, for instance, this bridge, has to be constructed somehow. And you can't just wave your wand and magically it appears. You've got to piecemeal construct the span, put the cables on. And then what happens if there's a big storm while you're building it? Well, it turns out that they had very accurate weather forecasts during the construction of this, because it was not possible to construct this in windy weather, so that they had to be very careful. This Viaduct de Millau in France is definitely worth visiting. Wind turbines, well, again, the scale is huge. These are perhaps 50 meters long, these blades. Now, 50 meters, it's probably only maybe 10 meters to the back of the room. Go five times further, that's how long these blades are, and the shape is carefully manufactured, and they've got to be strong to withstand very high winds. And all of this is done perhaps 60 or 70 metres up in the air, which means they've got to be reliable, because you can't maintain them very easily. And if your thing is nuclear power instead of wind power, then you might ask yourself, what is the shape of these cooling towers? These cooling towers are necessary to extract heat from the reactors, and well, why are they curved like this? What's the mathematical shape of these things? And all these questions, they're mathematical, but they have very practical applications. And then, of course, last year when the Philae lander landed on the comet, this isn't the Philae lander, but it's spacecraft, we got all excited, and you think, wow, this is a victory for science. Well, it's a victory for engineering, really, because the science necessary to get every single component in this thing working, and working for years and years and years, sending data back. It's pretty amazing. So I want to tell you a little bit of a story about how I got into engineering. Because I started wondering, I was looking around, I kept on thinking, gosh, well, how are things made? Just sitting in the kitchen, you're looking at a coffee pot. I was always interested in taking things apart. And I found that I could take things apart, but I couldn't put them together. I wanted to know what were the essence of how things work. And I realized, perhaps only relatively recently, that you've got to be able to understand very everyday things. You want to be able to understand really complicated things. So here's a very everyday thing. You might have heard of the particle theory of light. Who's heard of the particle theory of light? A few people. The particle theory of light says that light is made up of photons, little tiny particles. They're very, very small. We know that light reflects off a mirror. So if we imagine I've got our photon and it hits a mirror, well, we know that angle of incidence equals angle of reflection on a mirror. So that's fair enough. Our photon bounces off the mirror. It might bounce off another mirror, and it could bounce off lots of mirrors. It's kind of a waveguide idea. So I'm going to do an experiment using a bouncy ball. Bouncy balls here. I've got, use this one here, I think. I've got a, I don't need the cat. I've got a table here, which represents the bottom table, this one. The bottom represents the bottom mirror, and the top one represents the top mirror. So here are my two tables, and I'm going to bounce the ball in like this, and it ought to go bounce, bounce, bounce. Are you going to catch it? Okay. Right, so I ought to head out that way. Okay, so let's try the experiment. Maybe this has turned the wrong way around. So you knew it wasn't going to come your way. So what's going on? This is just a little bit annoying, because we thought that the particle theory of light was a good theory. Well, it turns out particle theory is fine, but this definition of a particle is that it has zero size. This particle does have size, and it can spin. And when we think about this thing possibly being able to spin, well then let's think about it. We've got to think carefully about each individual bounce. The first bounce of the ball, well, it hits the bottom mirror. What happens on that first bounce? Well, let's have a look closely. Take this ball here, and I bounce it. Can you see that ball is spinning? I don't know if you can see that from the back. Can you see that it's spinning? After that first bounce, the ball is spinning. There's nothing we can do about that. When you bounce a ball at an angle, it starts to spin. Now we've got a spinning ball heading up towards the top. And that then means that, well, it comes back. Why does it do that? Well, backspin, if I have a ball with spin on it, the ball comes back to me. But if you look closely at what happens, it doesn't just come back, but the spin direction reverses. And again, I don't know if you can see that. Can you see that? The spin direction reverses. Why does the spin direction reverse? Okay, well that's the next question. Number one thing is to use your eyes and be observant. And that's what the first step of any scientific investigation is, to be observant. So it reverses, spin direction changes. And then now we've got top spin, and with top spin, the ball's going to go over that. So by doing relatively simple little experiments, we can work out roughly what's happening. Then we can do, this is where the maths comes in. Because what I've done here is to make a mathematical simulation of what goes on. Now, the maths I've used are really simple things. I've used the law of conservation of energy, because I'm working on the principle that one of these balls, when it bounces, let's assume that the energy, no energy is lost. With a bouncy super ball, that's not too bad an assumption. And the other thing I'm going to use is the law of conservation of angular momentum. And it's not something that you do at school, but it's something we'll talk about quite a bit today. And just with a couple of equations, I apply those equations at the first bounce. So here we're coming in with no spin. At that first bounce, energy conserved, angular momentum conserved. And that's what the maths tells you. And then that's what the maths tells you. And then that's what the maths tells you. It all happens very fast. If we look closely, this is what happens with a high-speed video. And you can do this. Now, most of you have got phones with decent cameras on them. You can probably do this yourself. And what you see is exactly what the mathematical simulation told us. The ball comes in without spin, starts to spin, it bounces back, spin direction reverses, and out it comes. The beauty of this is, well, it's a victory for maths, because it explains really well what you observed, something which you might not have expected. But why is it useful? People complain that these kinds of things aren't useful. Well, this is why it's useful. This was taken from the World Cup back in 2010, some of you may remember. Who remembers Lampard's disallowed goal? Okay, that was a memorable occasion. So what happened, for those of you who don't remember or who are not interested, what happened was the ball came in, hit the bar, crossbar, went over the line, should have been awarded a goal, but it bounced out again. So look, the ball goes in, crosses the line, then comes up again, and hits the bar and comes out. Now, it turns out that if you do a little bit of maths on this, not much maths at all, that it is impossible for the ball to hit the crossbar twice without the ball crossing the goal line. Now, the ref ought to have known that, ought to have understood the laws of crossbar. It's really dark. It's somehow, I don't know why it is, that maths, science, physics, chemistry, these are all geeky subjects and not relevant in ordinary everyday life. But of course they are. Now, there is something to be said perhaps to have a law in football that says if the ball hits the crossbar twice, it's a goal. Make it much simpler. Well, because it's the laws of physics. Who knows what's going to happen in the next couple of weeks? We might see another one of these disallowed goals. I've been involved in making television documentaries about spinning things. I want to show you this one.
In 1942, a man called Hans Wallace had an idea. He would design a very special bomb. It would bounce across water and destroy Nazi dams.
You're going to attack the Great Dam of Western Germany.
The 1950s film The Dam Busters carried the story into British legend. The science behind the bouncing bomb is complex, and Wallace's working calculations have been lost. Now, a Cambridge engineer is going to try to work out exactly how he did it by attempting to do it all over again.
When you turn the graph on that, I never got
it. In a colossal experiment, he will rediscover the brilliance of Wallace's achievement when he tries to hit a dam with a bouncing bomb. The journey from drawing board to dam will be difficult and dangerous. Can history be repeated?
The thing about that whole exercise back in 1942 was that basically the physics was simple. You definitely come across a SUVAT formula for working out the trajectories, parabolic trajectories of particles. Well, you think, wow, I can just do that, I can do those calculations. And that's exactly what you have to do, but there's a little twist. Because when you've got a spinning particle, in this case a spinning bomb, then interesting things happen. Now, I've got a couple of coffee cups here stuck together and a rubber band. And I'm going to wrap the rubber band around because I can propel the coffee cup away from me, with some backspin. The purpose of the backspin is to generate lift. And it's really interesting that if you have a spinning object in the air, you get lift. So you see how that kind of hovers through the air without the backspin. And you notice this in tennis when you're watching Wimbledon, you'll see that people put backspin on tennis balls to make them hover. And they put topspin on to make them dip really quickly. So let's do it again. Put lots of backspin on. And it hovers through the air. Now that meant, for Barnes Wallace's bouncing bomb, that meant that the bomb didn't crash into the water and break up on impact. Terribly important. Let's see what happens if you put topspin on. And then this, of course, is relevant for tennis. If you put topspin. Topspin is the opposite. And it crashes the object down to the ground. The great virtue of topspin when you're playing tennis is that if you put topspin on, the ball can go hard, fast over the net, and then dips down quickly, doesn't go over the baseline. Understanding the spin is really important. And understanding the spin is it means then that you can use your Suvat formulae, but you have to add an extra term for the lift due to the spin. So spin, let's see how much we understand, and for that matter, don't understand about spin. One of the things that perhaps you messed about with when you were perhaps 2 or 3 or 4 was a spinning top. And we know that a spinning top, well, it doesn't stay up on its own. Spinning top needs to be spinning, but it needs to be spinning fast enough. There's a critical speed to make this top stay up. Now, there's a few questions you might ask if you're interested in maths. You might say, how do I work out the critical speed? How fast does this top have to be going for it to stay up? And it turns out there's a formula for it. How do I work it out? Well, when you're 2 or 3 or 4, you're not interested in that. But with any luck, as you get older, you are interested. But why is it that we don't ask questions about everyday life as we ought to? Because I think this is really interesting. The other thing that's interesting is that if you start to top off at an angle, you'll see that it wobbles around like this. And that wobbling motion is called gyroscopic precession. And as soon as you know what the words are, you can find things out. So if I put gyroscopic effect into Google, I find out a lot more than if I just put in spinning top. So a lot about understanding the world around us is knowing what words to use. Now, once we start looking up the gyroscopic effect, and if you look up this word gyroscopic precession, you'll discover that the Earth is a spinning object. And every 26,000 years, the axis of the Earth, which is inclined at 23.5 degrees, every 26,000 years, the axis of the Earth wobbles around. And blimey now, that's called precession. So gyroscopic precession affects the planet Earth. It affects so many things. And it's really nice to get to know these things. And we don't get taught them all at school. It's a bit of a shame. And then we think, well, what else can we... what other spinning objects might exhibit similar? A wheel. Here's a wheel. I know that I can roll this wheel. If I don't roll it fast enough, it falls over. But if I do roll it fast enough, it stays up. How do I work out the critical speed for the wheel to stay up? Well, it's the same idea. And if you roll the wheel at an angle, it goes around on a big curve. And that's called precession again. Now, what happens, for instance, if I attach a string to this wheel? I've got a stunt peg here. Some of you will have these on your bikes and stunt peg with a piece of string. And I'll put that on. Because when I spin this wheel up, if I hold it like this, you expect the wheel to hang vertically downwards. If I spin it up like this, the wheel stays up all on its own. And believe it or not, this is called gyroscopic precession. And if you think about it, it's the same motion as this, but just instead of the angle being 10 or 15 degrees to the vertical, the angle is 90 degrees to the vertical. And then you think, does that gyroscopic precession at 90 degrees to the vertical work with the spinning top? Well, easy is to attach a piece of string to the top. And let's see if we can do that. Sure enough, it does. Now, what we're doing is we're saying, OK, I really want to find out the equations that describe something I see. But they're a bit hard, or they're something I can't do right now. I can do it, give me some time. But the experiments are quick. Find out what you want to know about in the world around you. Find out what interests you. And then go and study it, because the time it takes to get to know all the maths behind what you want to go and study is a lot of effort. But looking around, go to museums, go to hands-on museums and galleries where you can see things. Try to find out, explore on the internet. Find out what you want to find out more about. Be curious. Now, one of the things that I'm really obsessed about is understanding the terminology, because everything has a name. And if you understand why the names are there, and you understand what the names are for, it helps. Some of you will have come across the word moment. If you have a moment, you know what I mean? If you have a moment or talk, twisting. Well, the thing about the word moment is it doesn't tell you very much. The word that I use for a moment is a couple. And it's an old-fashioned word, but it's a nice word. A couple, it's another word for a moment, is when you have two forces, a couple of forces. One force here, and another force there, but not in line. And that's what you have on this wheel. A couple. One force up in the string, and gravity acting down within the middle of the wheel. Now that couple has a direction. And thinking about the direction of these things is rather interesting. Because you could either have the direction, you define the direction by the axis about which it acts, but also whether it's this way around or that way around, positive or negative. In the same way as a force has a direction. So if I had a force, I've defined an axis along which it acts, and it's going to be either that way or it's going to be that way. So when you're thinking about couples or moments, you can think of them in exactly the same way as you might think about forces. Now, Isaac Newton was pretty hot on this. He really understood that if you understand how forces work, if you understand well, this law, F equals ma, which I think most of you will come across, is linking an applied force with mass and acceleration. The really neat thing about a formula like this, it's the equal sign in the middle. It says that what's on the left-hand side must be the same as what's on the right-hand side. Now, the thing about forces is that they have direction. So that means that not only is F equals ma telling you the numbers, but it's also telling you the direction. So if the force is in a certain direction, the acceleration will be in that same direction. Now let's have a little think about this. If I have a little car here, and supposing I think in terms of momentum, which is mass times velocity, then momentum is conserved if there's no force. If we have no force, that red isn't going very well, but if we have no force, no friction, then we know this car is going to go along at a constant speed. So our F equals ma. The F is zero, the A is zero, no acceleration. There's no acceleration, speed is constant. Conservation of linear momentum. Now, I'm going to come back to that. What I want to do now is to think of motion not in a straight line, but in a curving around in a circle. So who's done circular motion in any of your maths or physics courses? Some of you have. So some of you will know about this, but most of you won't, but I want to show you this. Have a tennis ball, weighs 40 or 50 grams, not a lot, and I have a, this is 2 litres of water, yeah? Heavy? Yes, it's full of water, right? Okay. That's 2 litres of water, and what I'm going to demonstrate is that I can lift up this 2 kilograms of water with my 50 gram tennis ball. Because if I just drop the thing like this, the 2 kilograms wins because it's heavy. But if I spin this around, now the tennis ball wins. Tennis ball wins, lifts up the 2 kilograms. What's going on? Well, okay, it's a bit tricky. It's a thing called centripetal acceleration, but the thing I'm most interested in is this F equals ma bit, because we know from the direction of the string that the force is along the string. Strings can only pull along the string. And if F equals ma is true, the acceleration of this ball must be towards the centre of the circle. Why? Because it's not accelerating, you think. If the velocity stays constant, if something's going at a constant speed, you think it's not accelerating. And that's why we get so confused by this. And this is where we really need to think about our arrows. Arrows are important. Because let's suppose, here's my velocity. Okay, I'm going along like this in a straight line. Along comes a force and it pushes me along. My velocity increases. Okay? That's because I've got acceleration, change of velocity. Now what happens if the force comes along and hits me sideways, a rugby tackle? So I've got my velocity like this, and now this force comes along and it hits me at right angles to my velocity. Well, I add these arrows together. I've now got a right angle triangle here, and I've got a new direction, because that plus this gives me a new direction over here. So I'm going along like this, sideways force, add them together, new direction. The force is changing my velocity, not in magnitude, but in direction. And that's what's happening here. The force is continually changing the direction of this velocity, and not its magnitude. It's a very subtle thing to come to grips with, but really important. So the moon is going around the Earth at constant speed, but it's continually accelerating towards the Earth. Isaac Newton had a wonderful demonstration of this. He said, imagine an apple, and I throw it, and it lands over there somewhere. Now I throw it harder, and it lands somewhere over in the other side of London. Throw it harder still, and it lands over in New York. And I throw it even harder, but because the Earth is curved, it keeps on going, it misses, goes over New York, goes all the way around, it comes back, hits me on the head. It's never landed. That is normal. That's what the moon is doing. It's falling. The moon is falling continuously towards the Earth on a curve which is exactly equal to the radius of the Earth, or the radius of its orbit. Now, It's all maths. These arrows, they're called vectors. It's all maths. Now, some of you might know this guy, Guy Martin. He and I did the War of Death just recently on Channel 4, which was good fun. And he was absolutely amazed that there were actually equations that describe what he does for a living, riding his motorbike fast around corners. And so he spray painted them on the wall. And he thought it was great. He just didn't realize how important it was to use maths to understand something like a wall of death, riding a motorbike around a vertical wall. Maths gets everywhere. Angular motion, though, gets, and spin, does get a bit confusing. I want to do a little demo. Who wants to be a volunteer for me? Going to volunteer. You'll be right in the middle. You're right in the middle of it. Clamber over the front and then over. That's it. Right. What we're going to do is talk about angular motion. Your name is?
Cameron.
Right, now Cameron. Spinny, swivelly stool here, right? So you're going to stand on this, right? Like this. You're okay with this? You'll find out. Okay? So that's, I'm going to give you a little gentle spin to get your sea legs, as it were. You happy with that? Oh yeah, okay, I don't mind if you want to follow me around. If you want an unvolunteer, that's fine with me. You did? Oh, I might be a little slow. I'm going to get to this, but I'm going to follow this. I'll give you a second. Okay. Right, so Cameron is on a swivelly stool where there is no friction. Now, remember I said when you're moving in a straight line with no friction, the car had conservation of momentum. Well, I'm going to provide a couple here. There we go, two forces. And now Cameron has conservation of angular momentum. So this is conservation of angular momentum, where there's no friction, and Cameron spins at constant angular velocity. Okay, very good. That's the first part. You get off there. Now, the thing about angular motion is that what is the definition of mass when it comes to angular motion? There's an angular idea of mass. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to give Cameron a couple of these things here, right? Now, when you hold these close to you, like hold them up there, right? You turn around like that, you haven't got much angular mass. But if you hold them up like that, it feels a lot heavier, doesn't it? Okay. So you haven't changed your actual mass, you've just changed your angular mass. Right? So now we get back on here with those figure things, right? So now if you hold them close to you, right? Cameron's got a small angular mass. Right? I can feel that as I apply my couple, and the couple gives a large angular acceleration. Now give yourself a large angular mass, and now, suddenly, Cameron's heavy. But he's not heavier, he's got a high angular mass. Now, imagine conservation of momentum, mass times velocity. Well, conservation of angular momentum is angular mass times angular velocity. Cameron can change his angular mass, which means he can change his angular velocity, which is what ice skaters and ballet dancers do. So what Cameron's going to do now is he's going to put his arms out at full stretch, and I'm going to spin him around gently like this. And then what you're going to do is you're going to bring your arms slowly. Whoa, that's it. They're just very slowly. Bring them in slowly. That's it. Keep going. Keep going.
That's all.
Really? Arms at full stretch. Do it again. You just do it really slowly because then you keep your balance well. Okay, wait. Okay, arms in slowly. Keep going. More. Whoa, very good. Fantastic. Okay, that's great. Thank you very much. Brilliant demo. So this is the, thanks, that's it. Thanks. This is the essence of what sounds complicated, but it's not. Conservation of angular momentum. What it means is that this thing called angular momentum, and there's always math symbols here, J is our angular mass, and this symbol omega, Greek letter omega, is often used for angular spin, If I reduce my angular mass, big J goes to small j, my angular spin, little omega goes to big omega, because the product of these two things is conserved, like mass times velocity. Right, let's have a look at what this means in reality. So here we have Winter Olympics a few years ago, and this ice skater, there's very little friction down here, and what she does here, she gives herself a kick off, and you've got her bum stuck out there, you get a large angular mass, and now small angular mass. So the spin increases, okay? And it's quite hard work, this. So, right. I'm going to try and do the same thing. So I have to stick my bum out. Okay, it's difficult. I haven't handed it to these people. They're pretty good. Conservation of angular momentum has so many beautiful nuances to it. Here's one which I particularly like, which is how you might point yourself around in space. Now, if I have a wheel in space, I can use conservation of angular momentum, which works like this. I stand on my swivelly stool, just to prove that I'm on my swivelly stool, I'll swivel myself around like this. Okay, now, I'll stand on my swivelly stool, but by conservation of angular momentum, if I spin the wheel clockwise, then I have to go anti-clockwise. That means that if I'm out in space, I can point myself wherever I like. I can go over there, stop there, or I can go over there, stop there. Now you kind of think, well, yeah, that's obvious, isn't it? Well, maybe, but seeing it is pretty impressive, but just wait for this. What happens if I have my wheel spinning clockwise? When I'm on my swivelly stool, what happens if I tip it upside down? Because now my wheel's going anti-clockwise. So how does conservation of angular momentum work if I go on my swivelly stool, I spin the wheel clockwise, I go anti-clockwise, then I tip the wheel upside down. And you think, wow, this conservation of angular momentum stuff is incredible. So what happens is, out in space, spacecraft have got what are called reaction wheels. Oops, losing my balance here. Spacecraft have what are called reaction wheels, which they can spin up and move around to do exactly this. So when the Philae lander has to land and point its legs directly downwards, you kind of think, oh, the way they do it, you watch those films, Interstellar and all that, they have these little gas jets they keep on spurting out. But where do they get the gas from? It's going to run out of gas. The good thing about these is that all you need is an electric motor to spin them up, powered by solar power, and you can go forever. So the vehicles that the Far Horizon went to Pluto, well, it had to turn its antennae around to point to the Earth, and then it had to turn its cameras around to point to Pluto. And we didn't hear anything about this because it's too complicated or too boring. I just think it's so interesting how just understanding conservation of angular momentum. Well, for me, it makes a big difference. So you can turn the wheels around and your spin, your total spin, your total angular momentum is conserved. Now, you can have fun with things like tennis rackets, baseball, and table tennis bats. Because you kind of think that if I spin something out in space, it'll just keep on spinning and it won't change its orientation, like the Earth spins, it doesn't change its orientation. Try this little experiment. Take a tennis racket, red on one side, white on the other, so you can see which side's which. I'll toss it up in the air like this, red facing you. Now it's white. Now it's red. You cannot toss a tennis racket up without doing a flip. Who's got a mobile phone at the moment? Okay. Right. So when you take your mobile phone, try this, you toss it up, and it will always come back. So here the clip is on the right-hand side. Now the clip's on the left-hand side. It will always do a flip. Now this is conservation of angular momentum, thank you very much. And it applies to things like, you know, a book. I've got a book here, pulling that way up, give it a spin, comes back upside down. Why? Now this is complicated maths, but such an easy experiment to do. And you might just be thinking, I want to know more. And that's the whole point of my talk today, to make you think, I want to know more. So conservation of angular momentum applies to a cat. I brought a cat along today, but this one doesn't have a brain in it, so it doesn't land on its feet when you drop it. But this one does have a brain in it. And if you look closely, you'll see that this cat lands on its feet. Now, this is conservation of angular momentum. And what happens here is that the front end of the cat, the head end, spins clockwise, and the tail end spins anti-clockwise. And then the cat has to straighten itself out. But the essence of it, it's complicated because it's three-dimensional, but the essence of it is that one end of the cat goes one way and the other end of the cat goes the other way, conserving angular momentum. And if a cat can do that, then so can I. And the way it works is this, that if I move my arms in one direction, my body goes in the other direction. Easy enough. But if I have my arms close together, the angular mass of my arms isn't very much. So, large angular mass going one way, small angular mass the other way. Large. And it's, I'm not doing any maths here, I'm just having fun. And then we can do the maths, and anyone who does trampolining, anyone doing trampolinists around, you can do some amazing things, which you don't have to do the maths on, but you can just understand. Right, I'm going to finish now with boomerangs. The boomerangs, they spin, and they have, therefore, gyroscopic precession. How do they work? Well, aerodynamic lift. When you have an airflow around a wing, you get lift. That's because air is deflected downwards. Every action has an equal and opposite reaction. Forget anything that people tell you about Bernoulli's principle, that's too complicated. This is very simple. If you manage to deflect air, you'll get some lift. Now, a boomerang has wings on it. This is a cross-shaped boomerang. Normal boomerangs have kind of look like this, but these are not so efficient. You can imagine that this one here is just two of these stuck together. But they're wing-shaped. Now these wings are important. They generate lift. But we've got a spinning object, and it's moving with a certain speed. Now, because it's spinning and moving, what it means is that if the center has a certain speed, represented by the black arrow, the center is moving with that speed, you can then, by relative velocity, because of the spin, the top must be moving faster and the bottom must be moving slower. Because the top is the same speed as the middle plus the effective spin, and the bottom is the same as the middle but minus the effective spin. Now that means that we get more lift on this wing than on this one, because it's moving faster through the air. More lift here than there means I've got spin, and that I also have a couple. I've got two forces that are not the same, and they're not in line. And what happens when you have a couple which is at right angles to the spin? You get gyroscopic precession. And that's why boomerang works. You get gyroscopic precession going on. Now, that the room is not quite big enough for that big boomerang, so I'll demonstrate gyroscopic precession with this one. With any luck. Come back. So there is my chance. Recession. That's quite fun. It always seems to work. Just. The nice thing about these boomerangs, these are the ones that we'll be making in the workshop, is they're made of balsa wood, which means when they do hit you on the head, they don't hurt, it's not very much. Here we go. So this is why I think that... This is why I think that understanding a little bit about maths isn't... There's only so much maths you can do at school. The maths that you really want to be getting into will be at university and actually, hopefully, for the rest of your life. And with that, I'll end my talk and I hope you enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you very much.